So today, during the last meeting for categories and functors, today we shall demonstrate how certain classical constructions in mathematics can be put in categorical language beneficially. Take any category, an object in this category is called an initial object if it admits exactly one morphism into every other object. Say A is an object, then MAB must be a singleton set for every B inside C. So it is called initial object. Exactly dual to this, if A admits exactly one morphism from every member B into itself, then we will call A a terminal object, which is the same thing as saying MBA is a singleton for every B inside C. If A happens to be both initial object and a terminal object, it is possible, of course, then this is called a zero object. Okay. So this terminology is again copied from like abelian groups or any other abelian kind of things, or even group theory also, like rings, fields and so on. Okay, so we will see why these terminologies help us and how they help us. In the category of all sets, the empty set is an initial object, but it is not a terminal object. Also, every singleton set in ENS is a terminal object, but not an initial object. Categories such as the groups, abelian groups, vector space over a field, R modules, etc., they all have zero objects. The zero space or whatever, the zero group, will have exactly one homomorphism from it to any other group. Similarly, there will be exactly one homomorphism from any group into the trivial group, zero group. So zero element, which is, if we multiplicatively, if you write, it will be the identity element, the singleton identity group, is both an initial object and a terminal object. So this is called a zero object. There is a simple way to turn an initial object into a terminal object by considering the opposite category. In category C, if A is a initial object, in category C op, it will become a terminal object, and vice versa. So you see, ENS had an empty set as an initial object, but not a terminal object. But if you take ENS off, it will become a terminal object, but not an initial object. So it's easy to produce categories which may or may not have any initial object, or may have many of them also, and so on. Okay. In any category, it is easy to see that any two initial objects are equivalent in the sense of that category. Okay, so this is simple observation which helps to understand many part of mathematics very easily. Okay, likewise, a terminal object will be also unique if it exists. Unique in the sense of equivalence classes. Within that category, they will be equivalent. Or you can say isomorphic or whatever. Now, a zero object has some more structure inside it. For every AB inside C, there is a special morphism 0 A to B. The morphism itself will be denoted by 0 A to B, which is the composite of unique morphism A to 0 to B. Now, this 0 I am using to denote the zero object, which is obviously a unique element. So I can have a symbol for it. Okay. So take any A and B in that category. Then A to 0, there is a unique morphism. And 0 to B, there is a unique morphism. Take the composite of this. That will be denoted by the zero morphism from A to B. So 0 AB. So nobody told you this one, but it is as now consequence of these axioms that such an element exists. Okay. These morphisms have the additional property that for any morphism F from D to A, G from B to E in C, we have, if you pre-compose F with 0 AB, it will be 0 DB. Similarly, if you post-compose G with 0 AB, it will be 0 AE. So G is from B to E, whatever. So they are all different zero morphisms, but composing with the zero morphism, any morphism, either this side or that side, right side or left side of a position 0. Okay, so this conforms with our experience with the zero homomorphisms of abelian groups, rings, and so on, or vector spaces, and so on. Okay, so we will come back to initial object and terminal object, but right now I will give you a construction now, because that is what my aim was in this lecture. So pullbacks. We had introduced this one in part one in a very special circumstance, namely when you have a covering spaces or G covering spaces and so on, and you have a map from any space into the bottom space, the base space, then the covering could be pulled back onto the space X. Now we would like to do the same kind of thing in any category. At least we don't know the existence and so on, but we will know that there is a concept like this. Okay. So take any category, then fix a morphism from X to B and a morphism from E to B. Okay, so P is inside MEB and F is inside MXB. So B is here the base for both the maps. B is the codomain. That is the picture, okay? Once you have fixed this, you will define another category itself now. In that category, which I am denoting by CFP, so it depends upon the category C wherein you are working. Then it depends upon F and P which you have fixed, the two morphisms which you have fixed. So CFP is a notation. So this is going to be a category. I have defined it, how. So whose objects are commutative diagrams like this, namely f and p are fixed, z is any other object, okay, but then you have to take morphisms from z to e as well as z to x such that this square is commutative. P composite alpha is equal to f composite beta. Take such things, they will be the objects of this category. Next, I have defined what are the morphisms. Verifying that the compositions and all that will be automatic because they depend upon the property of C being a category. Okay. So, what is a morphism from one such object to another object? So, I have to take two such squares. Okay, so here z1 alpha 1, z1 beta 1, f and p are the same. Similarly, z2 alpha 2 here, z2 beta 2 here. So this is one commutative square. That is another, this is the first one, that is another one, second one. A morphism will consist of now a morphism from z2 to z1. One more extra here. All these things are given, right? So a morphism from this square to that square consists of one morphism z2 to z1 gamma such that the entire thing is commutative, namely gamma followed by beta 1 is beta 2, gamma followed by alpha 1 is alpha 2. Then the rest of them will be automatic. So such a thing will be a morphism. Okay, if you have another Z3 and if define like this, then obviously the composite will be the composite of gamma 1 and gamma 2 from previous. Because you are using the category C. So all that is obvious what we are going to do. So this itself becomes a category. So CFP is a category of diagrams, of the squares. Okay. Now, a terminal object in this category will be called the pullback of P under F. So a terminal object means it is some object like this, which will admit exactly one morphism from every other object. So if Z1 satisfies that property, for every other Z2, there is only one homomorphism like this. Exactly one, not at most one, remember that. So then Z1 will be called the total space of this pullback. The pullback map itself will be this beta 1. Okay, the notation will be F star of P, pulling P under F, F star of P. So that is notation F star of P. So the total space will be denoted by F star of E. The map to X will be denoted by projection map F star of P. Whatever. Okay, by this we mean the codomain of the morphism F star of P is X. Okay, and whereas its domain is denoted by F star of P. The uniqueness of the pullback, you see, this being a terminal object, the uniqueness of the pullback is obvious. Okay. So in part one, we gave a constructive proof of the fact that in the category top, namely topological category, pullbacks exist. The same construction you can try in various other small categories, but they may fail to give you the full satisfactory answer, that they may not be terminal objects in that sense. That part you have to verify. But quite often it may work. Okay. So you see, now because of this terminology, I have reduced the work of defining pullbacks. What I did for just the covering spaces. Okay. And prototype of that, I have defined it for umpteen number of cases, all categories, all morphisms. You construct a CFP in this way and look for the terminal object in that category. Oh, one single definition takes forever. So this is the beauty of categorical language. Okay. So, for example, recall that a category is called small category if its objects, each object is a set. Like ENS is a small category. Top is a small category. Many of them, rings, groups, they are all small categories because the object sets can be thought of as sets. They are subsets of the underlying set is a subset of can be thought of as a set. Okay. So, or you can say that they are in some sense subcategories of ENS. But that is not necessary. Small category, just the object sets are sets. That's enough. Okay. Let A be any set. Okay. And consider the category CA. Now I am going to define another category. And just in another example, whose objects are pairs AG. You understand? C is a category. I pick up A is any set, and then I am taking AG as a pair, where G is an object in C, and A is a subset of G. For example, this category C could be topological category. Then G is an object means what? G is a topological space. But I can talk about subset of that, just a subset. A must be a subset of that. Or this category may be a groups. Then every object is a group there, right? But then I can talk about a subset of that group. So this A must be a subset of that. Okay, so take such pairs, AG, where G is an object in C and A is a subset of G. Now, these are the objects of this CA I'm going to define. What are the morphisms? Morphisms are again commutative diagrams. See, A to G1, I have this picture, namely inclusion map. A to G2 also I have. And G1 and G2 are what? They are objects in this category. So this F must be a morphism in this category such that these diagrams come out. Now, this thing makes sense because this is a set theoretic, it's a small category. So you have to pass on to the subsets A to F composition as a ENS you have to do. Here also, this is some set inclusion. So composition here is nothing but what? Composition in the small category, in the ENS. So this diagram should commute, and F must be a morphism in the given category. If you are taking topological category, this must be a continuous function. If you are taking groups, it must be a what? Homomorphism. If this is a category of vector spaces, this must be a linear map and so on. Okay, so this must be a morphism in that category. So such diagrams will be called morphisms of this category. Objects are like inclusion maps like A to G1, the pairs of AG. G is a superset of A, or A is a subset of G. Okay. So this is a category. In this category, okay, take an initial object. If it exists, it's unique. If it may not exist, I don't know. If it exists, it's unique. Okay. That unique object, the initial object, will be called free object in C with A as a basis. This is the definition. What is the meaning of free object in any category? Okay. Now let us look at the examples that I am all the time telling about, namely groups or abelian groups or vector spaces or R mods and so on. What happens to this? This will be nothing but free group, free abelian group, vector space, or a free module over R with A as a basis. So all these four different things we have studied very thoroughly at different places. All of them can be studied in one single go by this or expressed. I don't say it can be studied, but express the ideas all about all of them in one single go. They are all free objects in a particular category, whatever category you are looking at. So if you have proved a theorem for free objects, it will be true for all of them, one single way. The construction could be also similar, existence of constructions. I mean, constructions for existence theorems. But it may not work. So you may have to keep modifying it. They are similar, but you know, always existence part, you'll have to use very special properties of the particular category that you are looking at. Okay, that cannot be generalized. So pullbacks, etc., are new, but these free objects were somewhat old. I will ask you one simple question. If you take C as topological spaces, what is the free object there? Think about it. So direct limit and inverse limit is the next object that I want to discuss. So go back to this example wherein we started with a partially ordered set and then converted it into a category. So that conversion was equivalent. You can recover it to get the partially ordered set, right? Namely, the category associated to a partially ordered set and objects are points of this X, members of this X. So X is a set, okay? And morphisms are precisely one single element if and only if X is less than equal to Y. If X and Y are incomparable, MXY will be empty. So that was the partially ordered set, and that was the category that associated it. Okay. Right? So we will use that now. We have seen how to view a poset as a small category. A directed set, okay, j comma, instead of x comma something, I have j comma less than or equal to, is a poset such that for every two elements I and j, there is a k such that I is less than to k and j is less than to k. You know, I and j may not be comparable. If they are comparable, then I don't need another k there. One of them is bigger than that. But if they are not comparable, this is an extra assumption on the directed set. It's not a, or it's not always true in a partially ordered set. Given any two elements, there is an element which is bigger than both of them. So that is the meaning of it. There is a k such that I is less than k, j is less than k. Such a thing is called directed set. It's a partially ordered set with extra condition. Okay. It is not difficult to reformulate this in terms of the category, corresponding category, okay? All that it means is, given I and j inside j, there is a k such that mik and mjk are non-empty. That's all. So I less than to k is equivalent to saying mik is non-empty. J less than to k is mjk is non-empty. Okay, you can talk about the same thing in slightly different language category. Now, a directed system, I am going to define, just as a covariant functor from this category. Now, this is, you have to think of this as a category, to any other category. If you have a covariant functor, okay, taking values inside C, then this directed system is in the category C. So a directed system is nothing but a covariant functor from a directed set. What are its constituents? For each element I in j in J, you would have an object here Fj, right? And for each I less than or equal to J, there will be a morphism from Fi to Fj, right? And then because it's a directed set, Fi, Fj are given, there will be some Fk for which Fi to Fk and Fj to Fk also there will be a morphism. So that is the picture of a directed set, directed system. Okay. Associated to a directed system, we can define a category now. Okay. See, like I started with A and contained inside G, and then a set A and a category, then I define this category of paths and so on. Okay, so CA I defined. Similarly, fixing a map F and P, I defined CFP and so on. So this game you have to keep playing. So whatever you concept you have, first fix a category and look at the data to begin with, and then out of that, you have to construct the correct category. In that category, you look for initial or terminal objects according to your test. So now what I'm going to do? So I am going to define another category which depends upon this system. The system, so I'm just writing CF because it is taking values in C. Just not to confuse, neither C or NRF, it depends upon CF. So as follows. So what is the objects first of all? The objects are the pairs here. First object here is A itself, which is the category in the category. Then all these alpha J's, which are morphisms for each J in J, where A is an object in C, and alpha J's are all morphisms from Fj to A. Remember, Fj's are given by this CF, okay? So you have to have these morphisms, okay, such that alpha I is alpha J composed Fij. Whenever Fij exists, Fij may not exist all the time. Fij is to exist only if I is less than equal to J, remember that. Okay, so we can represent it by this kind of diagram here. For each pair Ij, wherein J is bigger than or equal to I, or I is less than equal to J, you have a diagram. Diagram means what? This composite this, need alpha J composite Fij is alpha I. So this is your category now. This is your objects. Okay. So what are morphisms? Again, from one triangle like this to another triangle, you must have morphisms. So morphisms are expressed like this. Okay. Suppose you have A here and another one B here. For A, you have all these Fi's. Fj is going into A and beta is coming into B. So there must be a morphism in the category tau, let us say A to B is a tau, which fits all these diagrams for all J's and all betas, alpha J's, beta J's. So one single tau should commute. So that is a morphism. By the direct limit of the directed system, F, with a direct limit, now I'm talking about the directed system F, we mean an initial object in this category CF. Okay, note that in general, the category CF may be empty. Why? You see, there's a lot of things you have to have. The category must have morphisms like this for each I. If FI, M of FI A is empty, then there won't be any such thing. Even if one of them is empty, there is no, nothing like that. So there is lots of conditions here. Okay, this category itself may be empty, then there is no question of having an initial object. Okay, even if it's non-empty, there may not be initial object. If it exists, then only we say it is a direct limit. Once it exists, it is unique. Okay, so a direct limit, we mean an initial object in this category. We note that in general, the category CF may be empty. If C has terminal objects, suppose I take a terminal object A, then automatically all these morphisms will be there and they will be commutative also, because terminal object has this property. It's a unique map here. The composite has to be there, so the composite will be automatically this one. Okay, so it is non-empty at least. It's terminal objects, then of course this category is non-empty. However, there is still no guarantee that the direct limit will exist. Of course, an initial object exists, namely direct system. We have seen that it is unique. Okay, then we can have some notation, direct limit of FJs. Thus, the direct limit of a direct system in C is an object A in C together with the collection of morphisms alpha j from fj to a, because it is, after all, it is an object in this new category that I have defined, satisfying compatibility condition, this condition. Okay, and then it must have these things, conditions are that this must be also true. Okay, such that for every other compatible family beta j, there is a unique morphism tau from A to B, making the up diagram B. So if it's an initial object, for every B which has satisfied this property, there must be a single tau. That is an initial object. So this is the way, okay, a directed limit is defined every time, whether it's a direct system of groups, direct system of topological spaces, direct system of rings, direct system of algebras, and so on. So all of them can be talked about in one single language. So again, in the category sets itself, okay, every directed system has a direct limit. That may be due to the fact that there are lots of terminal objects there. Every singleton is a terminal object. It may have some such, you know, impact on that, that why the direct system exists. I'm not saying that is a proof or anything. Okay, so how do you do that? Take B to be the quotient of the disjoint union of FJs. Now, FJs are just sets. Take the disjoint union, then identify X with Fij of X, whenever X is in Fi. Fi, there will be a map from Fi to Fj. So Fij of X should be identified with X itself. So do this for all possible Fijs. Whenever X belongs to some Fj and there is a morphism further, you identify the map. Identify this element with the image of that, and so on. Okay, that quotient set will satisfy the requirement. This being a quotient of all these, automatically from each FJ there will be a map. Okay, the quotient map. So you will get a morphism, whatever requirement is there. same kind of construction. When I'm same, it is not the same anyway, because you have to worry about the group operations and module operations, vector space operations, and so on. But similar construction works in many other categories. These are all what are called as abelian categories or algebraic categories, which are abelian categories. There are various terms, such terms, which generalize many algebra, topology, analysis, computer science, and all that together. So that is the whole idea of category theory. Perhaps we are coming to a close now. We will start talking about other things now. Okay, so let me just give you one more example. In top also, for example, this works. Okay, what I have to do? Take disjoint union, just like we did in the sets. Do the identification also, but what is the topology? On the disjoint union, take the disjoint union topology, and on the quotient set, you take the quotient topology. So that topology, which you take direct system, is a very special case. Namely, it can be thought of as the co-induced topology. Okay. So many of these topological things that you have studied could have been worked in with category theory. On the other hand, topological ideas themselves will come back and generalize all this category theory, what are called as topos. So there are so many other things to do within the category theory. They very closely goes in the beginning it looks like algebra, but later on it becomes topology. In modern algebraic geometry, all these things are a must. We have to study all these things. So, for directed system, there is one small technical thing which helps. This has nothing to do with category theory. So, it's better to know that. Since I am talking about directed system, I will tell you that. Namely, suppose you have a subposet of a poset I. Okay, so this is a partially ordered set and this is a sub-partially ordered set. We say this J is final in I. Okay, it's called a final family usually in the terms, but as a poset is a sub-poset, it's final in I. Whenever for every I in I, you will have a J which will supersede that, namely J is bigger than I. For example, if you take natural numbers for I and take only the odd integers here, odd natural numbers, this will be a subposet, but it is final. Because given any natural number, there is an odd number which is bigger than that. It is like that. Okay, it is like this concept is similar to subsequence, the concept of subsequence. Okay, it's completely generalized like this. Okay, you don't need to go to category theory. This is done even in the classically. Okay, so what happens is, suppose you have a directed system Fi, and then you consider subsystem Fj. If one of the direct limit exists, then both of them will exist and they will be equal. Okay, so this is, I said, it is similar to subsequence. Now for subsequence, we know subsequence limit may exist, sequence limit may not exist in general, right? So there is a problem there. Okay, but here, if for co-final family, if this exists, then this will also exist. Okay, so directed systems are already like Cauchy sequences, not just general sequences. That is why this works. Okay, you can verify this one. This is just a remark that. Finally, I said only director system. I didn't talk about inverse system. There is no need, because all these things, all that you have to do is take C off, namely reverse the arrows. Instead of covariant functor, take the contravariant functor and do the same thing. What you get is inverse system. And a terminal object will be is the inverse limit. Okay, so that is easy exercise for you to think about. Okay. So after that, I have a number of exercises here. You can keep trying them. Some of them we will discuss in assignments and so on. So our next topic will be homology theory. That will be for another 5 weeks. Thank you.